This is the Rainbow Aviation video channel, and I'm your host, Brian Carpenter. In today's episode, part two of Bending Sheet Metal for Aircraft, we're going to be taking a look at using and setting up an aircraft sheet metal finger brake. This is a companion video for the Technically Speaking article published in the June 2017 Sport Aviation magazine. In part one of this video, we discussed in depth the theory and the process for developing a flat layout for manufacturing a sheet metal part. In this video, we will take it to the next step, the practical process of converting the flat layout to a bent sheet metal part. The tool that we use for bending sheet metal is called a brake, and there are several different types of brakes. A press brake, commonly found in manufacturing environments, uses a vertically positioned die bending the sheet metal over a stationary V-block. A cornice brake, which has a solid clamping bar the full width of the brake, is limited to simple straight bends, and then the box and pan brake. The box and pan brake is sometimes referred to as a finger brake. This is because of the individual fingers, which can be configured into nearly unlimited fashion to make some of the most complex sheet metal parts. If you're interested in purchasing a sheet metal brake for building experimental aircraft, this would most likely be your first choice. In our shop, we use a box and pan brake manufactured by Mittler Brothers. It has a very unique combination of individual bed fingers, as well as leaf fingers, and a complete selection of radius fingers from 1/16 of an inch all the way up to 5/16 of an inch radius. In part one of this video, we talked about the necessity for bending aluminum around the radius and paying particular attention to minimum bend radius. The amount of force required to bend sheet metal tightly around a radius can be quite substantial. As the sheet metal gets thicker, the amount of force required increases substantially. Normally, the brake is rated for the maximum gauge material that the machine is capable of bending. This requires that you select a brake compatible with the thickness of the material that you will be bending. For example, a 16-gauge brake is capable of bending 16-gauge, that would be 0.062 inches, in mild steel, and a 22-gauge brake is capable of bending 22-gauge, or 0.030 mild steel. Even though the standard for gauging brake capacity is using mild steel, we can get away with bending a little bit thicker material when bending aluminum. A 16-gauge brake could typically bend up to about 0.080 aluminum, and a 22-gauge brake could bend up to about 0.040 aluminum. You may be able to bend thicker material than the brake is rated for, however, it is possible to do permanent damage to the brake if you exceed its limitation. Keep in mind that the high-quality sheet metal brake is a precision tool. Keeping it in good working order and properly adjusted will allow you to make precision bends consistently. Fortunately, most of the small experimental aircraft use sheet metal thicknesses that are relatively small, typically from 0.016 to 0.063. As a result, some 15 years ago, we decided to go ahead and purchase a 16-gauge box and pan brake that continues to serve us well on a daily basis. If you're interested in purchasing a brake, selection of the gauge rating is only one of the criteria. You also must choose the width of the brake, which will determine how long a piece of sheet metal you can bend. And as you might imagine, both the gauge and the length significantly increase the cost. We have found that a high-quality 48-inch box and pan brake is probably the biggest bang for your buck. In addition, it's easy to move around and doesn't take up a lot of space. Before we can begin using the brake, it's necessary to make sure that we have it properly adjusted. Trying to make precision bends without first setting up the brake can become very frustrating. Remember, it's a precision tool. The adjustment mechanisms are located on each end of the brake. There are two adjustments that will be necessary any time that you change material thickness: clamping pressure and clamping finger setback. At first glance, you might think this seems a bit cumbersome just to bend a piece of sheet metal, but I assure you, once you've done it a few times, it's really quite simple. To start with, clamping pressure should be only enough to keep the material from slipping during the bend. One of the biggest and most common mistakes made is using excessive clamping pressure. Excessive clamping pressure can cause the fingers to shift forward, leaving inadequate space for the aluminum during the bend. Clamping pressure can be adjusted by the two nuts located on the stem of the locking cam. By adjusting the nuts up or down, the clamping pressure can be increased or decreased. Keep in mind that all adjustments need to be accomplished on both ends of the brake. Typically, we will stick a small sample piece of the material that we're about to bend 2 to 3 inches from each end of the brake. While engaging and disengaging the locking cam, we will make adjustments to the adjusting nuts until we have just the right amount of tension on the sheet metal. Next, we need to adjust the clamping finger setback. The purpose for this is to provide enough space between the bending leaf finger and the nose of the clamping finger at the point of maximum bend. If not enough space is provided at the maximum point of bending, damage to the aluminum or even the radius fingers is possible. Think about this. If you're applying 50 pounds of force on a 15-inch handle, the bending leaf that is making contact with the sheet metal is only 1/4 inch away from the bending axis. This is applying 3,000 pounds of force to the sheet metal and the clamping finger. The whole purpose of the sheet metal brake is to take advantage of this leverage. With the counterbalanced weight installed, the amount of force required to bend a piece of sheet metal is really quite small. If you find yourself applying an inordinate amount of pressure during the bend, it probably means that you just misadjusted the brake. Don't force it. Adjusting the clamping finger setback is quite simple. Move the bending leaf to the angle that you will be bending, this is typically 90 degrees, and insert your sample piece of aluminum used to check the clamping pressure in between the radius of the clamping finger and the bending leaf. We then simply release the locking clamp and rotate the adjusting screw knob in or out until we have approximately 1.5 times the thickness of the material between the clamping finger and the bending leaf. Having excessive space will typically result in a larger radius than the radius of the bending figure. This, of course, will throw off all of your bending calculations and subsequently the final dimensions of your bent component. Once we have adjusted the finger setback on both sides of the brake, we will re-engage the bracket locks and we're now ready to begin our bending of our piece of sheet metal. Positioning the flat layout for bending can seem daunting at first, but once you understand the basic premise, you will be saying to yourself, "Why didn't I think of that?" In part one of this video, we created a flat layout that consists of the flats and the bend allowance. The bend allowance, and hopefully only the bend allowance, is the section of metal that we will be bending in the finger break. The bend will begin at precisely the end of the flat selection and continue bending to precisely the beginning of the next flat selection. The trick here is how do we position the flat layout so that the beginning of the bend allowance starts at exactly the bottom of the radius finger. Keep in mind, this is the section of material that is underneath the clamping finger. Once clamped in place, we are unable to see at least half of the bend allowance section. So how do we precisely locate the mark on the sheet metal that denotes the beginning of our bend when we can't even see it? The trick is, move the mark. We call this the sight line. One of the known variables is the radius of the clamping finger. The distance from the bending axis to the leading edge of the radius finger, in our case, 1/8 of an inch or 0.125. By placing a sight line on the flat layout that is projected 1/8 of an inch from the edge of the bend allowance that will be under the brake, we now have a sight line that we can use as a positioning reference. By looking straight down from above the brake, we can align the leading edge of the radius finger with the sight line while clamping the flat layout in position. By default, this positions the beginning of the bend allowance at exactly the beginning of the radius on the clamping finger. Although it may appear close in some circumstances, the sight line is not the center of the bend allowance. As a result, if you create a sight line and then inadvertently position the layout 180 degrees from your intended position, this will completely reposition the bend allowance and your final product will be long on one flat section and short on the other. On parts containing multiple bends, you may find it more convenient to place the sight line on your layout after you decide which orientation is necessary. This will allow you to check for interference between the bent legs and the clamping fingers. In our maintenance classes, the students have a contest to see how close they can bend their part to the drawing dimensions of a sheet metal project. The students that perfect this technique can bend their parts to within 0.001 of an inch on the final dimensions. Working with sheet metal has always been considered an art rather than a trade. And like any artistic endeavor, building a sheet metal airplane, a component, or even doing a repair can both be satisfying and rewarding. And like any artist, having the right tools and knowing how to use them is the secret to making your canvas come alive. Well, we've come to the end of this episode on Bending Sheet Metal Part 2. We put a lot of effort into bringing you only high-quality, useful videos for the sport aviation market. If you enjoy what we're doing, please remember to like the videos. And if you want to stay up to date on all of the new videos that we create, subscribe to our YouTube channel.